most important feature. Okay, because in short, we can say that we are going to develop or we are going to write a startup file or modify the startup file so that we can include features for the bootloader. Okay, what is bootloader? First of all, what does that mean? Okay, so let us first try to understand what is a bootloader and how things actually work in that dimension. So we know that when we write our C program, it is taught that we start with the main itself, int main, and in that main function you will write some statements, or you may call some functions. Okay, and when you call this function, the microcontroller will go to that function, or we can call it subroutine. Okay, so it will go to that function where you will again write some statements, and when it will return, it will go back to the main program again. So this is how the C program actually is working. But in the last class we saw that it is not that the microcontroller directly goes to the int main. Okay, before going to the main function or before loading this so-called C program's feature and all, the microcontroller actually works in a different location, or we can say in a different location of the memory. And before coming here, before coming to the main, microcontroller actually completes some other task which we call are in the startup file. Okay, so we will again check where this microcontroller is going. So in the startup file, so now the problem is our memory starts from, assume it is starting from here, 0000 0000, okay, because it is 32-bit micro memory. Okay, so here I am drawing it in opposite direction. Generally the memory should start from bottom and it should grow upward. Okay, anyway, this time just for an exception we can look the memory in this way. So this is the memory that we actually work with, the ARM microcontroller or ARM based microcontrollers. So this is your 32-bit memory, and these memory are basically divided into of 8-bit registers. Okay, or 8 flip-flops, you can say. Now the question is, we know that always the microcontroller will start from 00. Why? Because after every reset, microcontroller's content, data content, and or the RAM, at the same time the program counter actually resets to 00. So when the microcontroller's program counter is reset, it goes to 00, and definitely the microcontroller's program is not going to load from main in that case. So the main, int main, should be somewhere before, should be somewhere after the execution of some important tasks. So what are the important tasks which actually should be executed before coming to the main? So some of the tasks are like pointing to stack memory, or tell the system where the stack memory is pointing, or you should tell the system this is where the stack is pointing, or you can change the stack location also. So first thing we have to decide is where the stack should be. Second, there is a function for floating point, because floating point means, I have discussed floating point in the beginning of this course, which kind of floating system or floating point system we have to use, that has to be declared prior to getting into the microcontroller's main program. Why? Because if we are not going to initiate in the right kind of floating point, then our whole program will be giving us error. So we have to define where the floating point is. Third, similarly, it is important to tell the system or inform the system about the interrupt locations, or we can say vector table. When I am saying here the vector table, it is not just about the interrupt, it is also about all the different peripherals or all the different memory segmentation and all. So vector table means here I am talking about every kind of data or memory location which should be arranged in a proper way, be it SRAM's location, be it flash memory's location, be it external memory's location, be it any other location. So this kind of task should be executed or should be executed correctly before coming to the main. After completing all this important task, the program counter will load the int main function. Okay, before that, it is important that we should complete all the so-called boot loading things. So this part we can call as boot loading. Okay, so basically there are engineers who are expert in writing boot loaders. That means the sequence of events that should take place before coming to the main program. So what kind of things we should do, or we can say this should be the first task, that is reset, because before getting in the power, whole system is reset. So after you give the power, the thing, first thing the microcontroller is executing is to wake up from the sleep, or we can say it was off and then it have to wake up. So after resetting, the first thing is to go to the memory location 0000000. Okay, every system do this same thing, whether it is microcontroller, computer or any other peripheral. Okay, so first you go to 00, execute some important task or important functions, arrange all the memory locations according to your scheme, and then inform the microcontroller, okay, everything has been done, peripherals have been checked, everything is okay. Now change the program counter towards, or locate or point the program counter to the location where int main is located, and from there onwards the microprocessor will follow the sequence of events which are there in the main and subsequently in the subroutines also. Okay, so before that, this thing has to be done, and this thing is actually, that means all the information regarding the sequence of events to be taking place before the int main is generally written in a file called startup file. Okay, so today what we are going to do is we are going to look into the startup file. Keeping in mind, we are going to use this file to create or to write interrupt based program. Okay, we are going to look into this startup file to write proper interrupt based files or interrupt based programs. Okay, so this is what we are going to do now. Anyone having any difficulty to understand this scheme, that when the system was reset after getting wake up or after waking up, the system program counter goes to the zeroth location, and in the zeroth location there should be some basic home, what to say, some basic programs to be completed before coming to the int main program. Okay, so this is all covered inside the startup file, and we will now go through all these files. Few files, like one is your main header file of the microcontroller. Header file of the microcontroller. Similarly, startup file, and might be possible we may jump to another file called core file. Okay, core.h file. This is generally written for that particular core. When we are saying core here, we are focusing on M4. M4. What is M4 here? Cortex-M4. Okay. Cortex-M4. So we are going to have a look in all these three files. We are going to correlate these things. We will be writing or modifying some of these files so that we can write proper programs for interrupts or to use interrupts. Okay, this is what we are going to do. So we will be keeping eye on all these three files and modifying some of these files or using some of the features of these files to write programs using interrupt. Anyone having any difficulty till now?
Sir, is it common to use startup files for any microcontroller to write interrupt programs?
It is not common, but we should know what is happening in the background. Okay, because now you will see in the startup file, many of the times you will find that the startup file will not be having all the definitions for all different kind of interrupts. Okay, so before that, first of all, try to understand whether this thing is clear or not. That when first of all we press reset, the microcontroller goes to, or the program counter goes to 0000, 0th location we can say. From there, the microcontroller start executing some basic functions, and only after completing those functions the microcontroller comes to the main and then executes the main program. Now the question is, if I have to introduce interrupt in my program, then I will have to tell the system or tell the microcontroller that this is the definition of the interrupt and the interrupt should be pointing at the right location according to the interrupt vector table. Okay, so here, because in the startup file interrupt vector table has to be defined, we have to modify them. It is not that all the interrupts definitions will be written in the startup file in the beginning itself. Most of the times the engineer or the designer will have to modify the startup file to accommodate all the interrupts he want to use in the program. We will come to this, okay? But anyway, so right now, is it clear why we are going to look into startup file and core.h file? Why it is important? Anyone having any difficulty? If not, then we can gradually go into the main program and see why what is happening here. Okay, clear. Now let us go to the program. So let me take an example of this program itself. In the last class, I told you that we can change the sequence of events, or we can tell the system that you do not have to go to the main file directly. Rather, you can go to another location from where the program actually starts. So for that, you just have to go to the project. Okay, go to project options and then go to the debugger and uncheck this particular function run to main. So now the program will not start from the main, rather it will be starting from some other location, and we checked that also. So I will just compile this program and then load this program to the microcontroller. For this, I have connected my microcontroller board with the computer. Okay. So now when I start debugging the program, okay, the program goes to a different location. Okay, wait a second. Let me check if I can take this out. Okay, I will leave it floating. So this is my disassembly window. And you can see, right now we are not in the main file. Okay, we have not reached to the int main function. So here, these are the details which we have to cover in this part. So the basic first memory location is 0000. And then you can see there is a table for base addresses. Then region limit, region when we are saying regions, let me just check if I can show you system. Memory mapping. Okay. So this is the overview of our system. So basically we have the memory map where first, you can see the memory location of 0000 to 3FF is for on-chip flash. Then some memory is blocked or reserved. Then comes the bit banding related SRAM. Then all these peripherals are there and so on. Okay. So if we come here, so these are the regions which are stated in this particular table limit. Okay. Now, then after that comes the vector table. Vector table means in general vector table. It is not the interrupt vector table. So, but here in the vector table, we can see it starts from 1, 2, 4, 8, C and so on. Okay, it goes on incrementing. What are these vector tables basically showing here? They are showing, these are, for example, this location 008. So, bus fault handler, then bus fault handler, bus fault handler, then 000. Let us go to what is this particular thing showing here. So for that, if I go to the exception model, let me check. Yeah. So this is one of the tables. There is another table for proper, which shows the total memory locations. Anyway, you can use this model also. You can see the exception starts from 000. Okay, so first of all, there are two parts. One is exception, and then you have interrupts. In both, why they are calling it exception and interrupt? Interrupts are generally from the peripheral side. Okay, interrupts are coming from peripheral side. All these are interrupts, GPIO, UART, I2C, PWM, ADC, timer. So they are calling it interrupt. And exceptions are system-based errors. When you try to generate or when you try to execute something which is generating an error from the system, then it will be exception. Okay. So exceptions like you have NMI, non-maskable interrupt, hard fault, memory management related issues like you jump from one memory location to another memory location. For example, if you are executing a program, and I showed you also that when we are executing recursive program or recursive function, our stack may enter into the SRAM location, which is not allowed. So in that case, what will happen? It will be throwing an error of memory related error. Bus fault. Bus fault means, for example, we are using port F. Okay. even before providing the clock to port F, if we try to say that, okay, this should be an output, DIR register. If we try to execute DIR register before providing the clock, then it will be having, or it will throw a bus fault error. Okay, because the particular bus is not activated. So similarly, usage fault, as we call debug monitor, okay, SysTick related errors or interrupt related errors. So now if you can see here, the priority starts from minus, here it is minus 4, you can say, then minus 3, minus 2, minus 1, and so on. So how can we look into that? For that, we can directly go to our header file. We can take a simple header file here, our, okay. In this, you can see from here that the, wait a second, I will keep it here. No. Okay. You can see from here, first reset, then non-maskable interrupt, then hard fault correlate from here. Okay, this, look at this part, reset, non-maskable interrupt, hard fault, and you can see the sequence here also, then bus fault, then after that, look, you have to keep an eye here, 0, 1, 2, 3, these are the vector number, okay, but the sequence here, you can see here, it is minus 15, minus 14, minus 13, minus 12. So after minus 12, then 11, 10. After 10, that means usage fault IRQ. So usage fault IRQ, you can see it comes here, and then there is all these locations which are reserved. Okay, so exception number 7 to 10 or 6 to 10 are not used, because then after that, after 10, you are directly jumping to minus 5, then minus 4, minus 2, minus 1. So these are all exceptions. This section is your exception. Exception means which are related to the system. Clear, first thing. I'm going slow because you should try to understand this thing beforehand. Then only we can modify this particular file, okay? So this is your header file, normal header file, in which it is telling you about the priorities and the sequence of exceptions. First of all, the exceptions are there. Why we are looking into that? You can see now from this point also. Okay, let me check if I can keep it there. Let me try.
Sir, any exception can come at any time. So what does sequence mean here?
Priority. If two events are coming simultaneously, then you have to give some priority to them, right? Which should be executed first, or whose priority should be given the higher priority, or which interrupt should be given higher priority and all. Any event can come at any time, but of course they have to have the priorities then in that case. Okay, for example, here you can see this is our IAR in the left. In the right side, we have our header file. So let us again cross check here. So after 10, bus fault error, then you have, after 10, you have four reserved locations. So 9, 8, 7, 6 are reserved. So 0, 0, 0, 0. Then again, error, that means your exception handler. Then again, exception handler. Then after that, you can see here between 4 and 2, there is no third minus 3. Okay, so there is one again. Reserved exception. Cross check it. You see, after debug monitor, we have a reserved exception. Okay, so similarly, this way, everything is correlated, be it your header file, and the same thing is executed in your compiler also. So after -1, this is your system exceptions. After that, when we start from 0 onward, we are actually entering into the interrupts location. So now we are going to look into the interrupts. So again, let us cross check whether the interrupts are properly arranged or not. So you see here, we are going to start from 0. So 0 is related to GPIO A, port A. Then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and so on. It keeps on incrementing, and all the interrupts are written sequentially. Okay. Now, when we come down, there is again a location which is reserved, which is not used for interrupt. That is after analog comparator. Okay. 42. You can come down and see here, after 40, you have 43. See here, after 40, there is 43. So it is not that the header file will be always correct. Okay. You will have to work sometimes with the header file also to keep an eye or correlate all the features or interrupts are written in the header file or not. You have to keep an eye on that also. If not, then you have to include these interrupts also. Okay. So now here 41, 42 is missing, reserved, okay, after CAN 1. So here if you come down, 41 and 42 is missing after CAN 1. This is CAN 1. Okay. And 41 and 42 is missing. See here, 41 and 42 is missing because they are reserved. Similarly, location 50, or interrupt number 52 to 56 are reserved. Let us go down. 52 to 56 is reserved. So 51 to, you see here, 51, after 51, it directly jumps to 57. Right? Why? Because 52 to 56 is reserved. So now you can make your own list of header files, or you can even cross check these header files are actually correct or not. So in total there are 138 interrupts, and here we can see in total there are 138 interrupts, and if you want, you can just cross check the reserved interrupts are at the correct position or not. Okay, so this is how first of all we write the header files interrupt location. Okay, first 15 are your exceptions which are generated by the hardware itself. Okay, but after that, from 0th location or 0th interrupt, all these are your interrupts which are from the peripheral. Okay, now first thing is this. So you have to keep an eye on the sequence of interrupt, and in general you don't have to worry about the header files. You will not be writing a header file until unless you are working on a very new IC. Most of the time the header files will be provided by the vendor himself, because this is provided by the Texas Instrument. Okay, or otherwise you can go to the C, you can go to program files x86, then go to IAR, okay, then embedded, then ARM, in that you can go to SRC, then lib, I believe somewhere here we have the header files, wait a second, no, thumb, here we have the startup file, wait a second, then I gave you the path for header files also. Let me just check. Go to ARM. Okay, you can here, you can check the header file TM4C. Let me check. So in this way, you can directly get the header file and you can include it in your project first thing. Okay, first thing about the header file. Anyone having any doubt what is this header file and why we are looking into this? And I believe you remember these are all structured. Okay, so you can see these are all structured based systems, enumerated structured based system. Okay, because these are all sequentially managed again according to the data sheet. So let me check if I have the .h file. Okay, sort by type. So see here you can get all the header files for different microcontrollers. Let me check the path, open file location. Okay, so in this particular file location you will get all the header files. So TM43123GH6PM.h. This is your header file for the microcontroller we are using in Tiva C. Similarly, you will get all the different microcontrollers header file in the compiler. Even if you are using Kyle, you will get the same all header files in the Kyle also. Kyle, I believe it is okay, let me check again. Okay, so whichever compiler you are using, you will get the header file from the compiler, or you can directly go and check in the Google TM4C123GH6PM header file, and preferably download the header file from the main vendor's website rather than using the header file from any other location. Okay, so they will provide you all the header files and all, so don't have to worry about it. Let me check. Yeah, this one is okay because this is coming from the Kyle itself. So Kyle is also very renowned, so you can directly download the header files from this. Okay, this 123gh. okay, either you can download it from here or use the compiler itself. They will provide you all the details, so don't have to worry about that. Now, till now we have discussed about the header file. Now let us look into the next part, that is our startup file. So what is happening now? This is our disassembly window. Okay, so now right now our program is working somewhere here. Where is our pointer now? Right now our pointer is somewhere at the IAR program start. So before coming to IAR program start, definitely program should have gone through all these locations. Okay, and then it jumped to IAR this location, program start. And then if we go down, wait a second. Yeah, okay, jump to main program, I think. The second main, stop. Okay, I will reset it. Wait a second. Okay, so from here we jump to the main, which is not the main we are talking about. So low level initialization takes place and then it goes through many different locations like low level initialization, and then it jumps to the next location, so call main, and from here it will call the main, and now we are entering into the main. So now you can see The pointer is located here also, green. It all automatically became green. So that means now we are in the main. So before coming to the main, the microcontroller is before coming to the main, the program is actually roaming in a different memory location, which is dedicated to maintain all the header files and all. So first of all, we talked about the header file for the interrupts and exceptions. Now the question is, to include a header file, include the interrupt, what are the things that we have to do? Okay, so we have to work with the startup file. So where is the startup file basically? If you go to this particular memory location in IAR, you will get the startup file for the microcontroller that we are using. Okay, so take this file, take this location. Okay, here you will get, here you will get the C startup underscore M dot C file. Copy this file and paste it in the project location where you are going to write your project. So suppose we are going to write a project here. Okay, so I have already pasted it. So there is a difference between, now when you look into the file, the startup file, basic startup file, okay, so this is the basic startup file in which now you can see in the beginning itself it has arranged all the exceptions. So this is the sequence of exceptions which are actually arranged in the startup file also. So if you check here, all the exceptions are there. Okay, IAR program start, then after that NMI, after, okay, NMI, then hard fault, then memory management, then bus fault, usage fault, reserved location, then after that you have SV call, then after that debug monitor and so on. Okay, so this is, these are all your exception handlers. Okay, now the question is, and then it is writing the sequence of all the exceptions in the vector table. So it is making an array in which it keeps all the exceptions. Now in this you can see that it is not using the interrupts, or it is not defining the interrupts in the startup file. And then what we are doing here, do you know what is this function basically? Underscore underscore weak, when we use this particular command, underscore underscore weak, because this is your function, void NMI handler void. This is your function, and whenever there will be an error due to NMI handler, you will, your program will be stuck here in this location. It will keep on, because it is while and one, it will keep on repeating here for infinite time period. Similarly, if there is a, there is an error from the hard fault or hard fault related error, the microcontroller will be here for infinite time period. Similarly, if there is an error due to SysTick related error, then your program will be executing this particular line for infinite time period. So here the problem is the startup file, okay, contains all the definition of your exceptions, but what about the details related to interrupts? So how can we include that part? Okay, so to include the, or to get into the interrupts, what I have done here is I have segregated these memory locations. So now let us see here, from here basically this was there in the startup file, Okay, so we are not going to modify this part. This is there, exception related thing. Now suppose if I want to use the interrupt due to timer A. Okay, so let us just briefly check timer A. So these are the list of interrupts. Okay, so timer A related interrupts, I am actually focusing on this one. Okay, so if I want to use an interrupt due to timer A, then in that case I will have to again write all the features for the handler. So I have to include the handler here. Similarly, just like your interrupt exception, we have written the same format: extern void timer A handler void. Okay, so this is your prototype. You can see why I am calling it prototype, because you have a semicolon here. So you have written the prototype here. So what is this extern doing here? Anyone? When we use extern in C programming?
To avoid any memory allocation?
No. To show that this function is not located in this file, rather it will be defined and executed from some other file, or it will be coming, this function will be defined in a different location. It will not be defined in this particular location. So that's why we are using extern function. Okay, so extern, then we have the prototype of the interrupt. Now coming down, this is the first part we have to do. Okay, then we come down and we have this locations for our exceptions, right? After that, because you see here, this is minus 15, 14, 13, 12 and so on, and here it comes to minus 1. Then we have to write the sequence of interrupts which are before the timer A. If you want, you can definitely include all the details, like start with 0. So 0th interrupt is for GPIO port A. You can definitely write here GPIO port A underscore handler. Then similarly, GPIO port B's handler, C's handler, and so on up to 19th. So why? Because timer A has an interrupt at 19th location. So what we are doing? We are writing 0, because writing 0 means I'm not going to use it now. Otherwise, if I am going to use it, I will put the correct handler name there. Okay, for example, if you need GPIO port A, if you are interested in generating an interrupt from GPIO port A, then definitely you will have to use this particular GPIO port A's handler here in this location. So how to know the name of the handler? Go to the header file. Here, this is the name of the GPIO port A's handler, GPIO A underscore IRQN. So first thing that you will have to do is you will have to write the prototype here. Then after that, include the handler at the correct position here, if you are going to use GPIO port A. Okay, now coming down, I have used, this is the second step to remember. First step, remember to include the prototype, including with the extern. Okay, extern. And then here in this place, it is not mandatory that you have to provide, keep the sequence. In this location, it is not mandatory. It is not mandatory to keep the sequence here. Remember, when you are defining extern void timer 0A handler, when you are writing the handler, it is not necessary to, because prototype can be non-sequential. It is not mandatory to keep the prototypes in a sequence. But in the vector table, because it is a vector, so we have to keep the sequence in the proper manner. So that's why when we are going to use the 19th interrupt, okay, then we have to, if we are not going to use these interrupts, then we can put 0 there. Otherwise, if we are going to use some of these interrupts, we have to write the proper handler there. How we will get the handler's name? From the header file. Okay. From the header file, we will get the name of the handler. Now, coming down, this is the second step to introduce the handler. So, define the handler prototype. Then, in the vector table, we have introduced that handler's name. Then, after that, these are all the definitions for exceptions. Similarly, we will have to write the definition for our interrupt also. So timer 0 a irqn void and while underscore underscore. Okay, so this is your program. Okay, now the question is, this is all defined. These three steps we have to accomplish. So if you are going to write about the all the interrupts, then just imagine what will be the size. Of course, you can write, or some of the, you may even find that in the internet also. Some people have developed the complete startup file for TM4C123, but I am not using it because I am not sure about their all the whether they are using it all sequentially or not, or if I blindly use them, then I may end up with some error which I will not be able to debug. But there are some people who have completely written all the details related to the header startup file. Now, if you can see here, there are around 138 such interrupts, or we can say 154 in total number, keeping an eye on the reserved also. Reserved, if you include the reserved. Reserved are not used, but in total, 138 usable interrupts are there. Okay. Out of 138, of course, there are some reserved also. So 138 interrupts are there. Now the question is, if you are going to include all those interrupts detail here, then of course, this file will become too lengthy. But it is a healthy practice. If you want to write, then write all the details. But otherwise, these three steps you will have to, minimum these three steps you have to do. First of all, take the startup file. Don't change anything in the exceptions. Let it be there. Next part is to include your prototype. Prototype is done. Same prototype name can be anything. It is not that you have to be very worried about this, okay, handler name. Now similarly, come down and include that same name of the prototype here for the interrupt. So for that, you can take the help of the header file. In the header file, you can go and take the name for the timer 0 is head startup file. So this is their handler you have created. Now after that, come down and then you have used the definition for your IRQ. Okay, up to this you have modified the startup file. Till this, you have just changed the startup file. Now what you are going to do in your project, you will be including the header file and the startup file, and then write the program according to the need. So let us briefly check how to use these things. Okay, so
step 3, sir, ek bar phir se bataiye.
Step 3 is nothing, just here. Okay. In the startup file, you are just telling the system, here you are declaring the function. That means if there is an interrupt coming from the timer A, and if it has not been defined in the main program, then your microcontroller will come to this location in the startup file. Okay, but we will be defining the interrupt in our main program. Okay, that's why our program will not come to the startup files, this function, rather it will go to the function in our header file. Let me briefly tell you about what we are doing here. Wait a second. Okay. What we are doing here. So we have the header file. Okay, we have the startup file. Okay, and we have the data sheet. Rather, I will keep it there. Wait a second. Here we have the data sheet. Here we have the startup file. So we will be taking the help of data sheet in both directions. Now, like I said, in the beginning, the header file will be having some details regarding the exceptions. Okay. And then the details related to interrupts. So here we saw an exception started from minus 15 to minus 1, and interrupt started from 0 up to 138. Okay, interrupts are coming from the peripherals. Exceptions are coming from the system related errors. Okay. These are errors. Okay. And here we have the interrupts, peripheral related interrupts. Okay. So how to track all the details from the data sheet? In the data sheet, we can see the list of interrupts and exceptions. Done. Now in the startup file, there are three sections. One is the section where you have to first include the exceptions related details are there. Because of course, every cortex will have this section will be same for every cortex M4 or whichever family you prefer or you choose. Okay. This exception related things will be same, but interrupts will be different for different vendors. Okay, this part is vendor dependent means it may be different for TI, will be different from STM, it will be different from Samsung and so on. Okay, Apple and so on. So it is, this part is vendor dependent. This will be always same. So startup file definitely will contain exceptions which are same. Done. Now after that, if we have to use the interrupts, definitely we will have to call the interrupt. So the first part is to define the prototype. Okay, prototype, we have to tell the prototype. Then after that, this is the first task. Second task is to tell the system, for example, here. Okay, here these are the prototypes of different exceptions. It starts with that. Okay, now here we have introduced our prototype for the interrupt handler, and we can name it any, we can give any name. It is not necessary that it should be timer R0A_handler. We are following this particular naming technique or naming protocol. Otherwise we can give any name. Okay, timer handler or timer A0 handler also can be provided. So there is no such compulsion that it has to be like this. So now since we have declared the prototype, we have to come down and add that interrupt handler at the correct position. So since we are actually focusing on timer A0's interrupt, we will go to the header file and check where this particular timer A0's interrupt is. And we noted that it is at the 19th location. Okay, so we have to introduce our handler at that particular position, 19th location. So that is the second job. So include the handler at correct vector position. That's done. And it is not mandatory that you have to take care of all the rest of the other handlers also, because here you can introduce with zero. If you need, you can put the name of the handler, correct handler here, like for GPIO A. In such case, you will have to write the prototype for the GPIO A also. The same name should be coming here in the first line. Done. This is the second step. Third step is to define the function. So this is the area where they have defined the functions for exceptions. So we have to introduce our exception also. So we will be using this area to write our exception. So now the name of the exception, okay, should be same here. It should be same as that of the exception in the header file. So the name of the exception here is timer 0AIRQN. That we'll be using here as the main function, which will be using the header file. So third part is, then after that, third part is to write the function for our interrupt. Okay. So now the question is, so that means whenever the interrupt will be generated, the microcontroller will go to this location or not? Yes, it will go to this location, provided we have not defined the function in our main program. Remember this part. Okay. If in our main program, if we have not defined the interrupt function, then the microcontroller will come and jump to this location. Otherwise, if we have defined it in our main function or main program or the main file or main.c file, then it will not come to this location. Rather, it will go to the function where we have defined the interrupt. Okay, so now the program can have the flexibility to go to two different locations. If it is defined, if the interrupt program or interrupt function is defined within the main program, it will execute from there. Otherwise, if it is not defined, it will execute from the startup file. Clear? Clear up to this part. So this is how we are going to look into the header file. So these are the three simple, straightforward steps we have to take, okay, to execute or to modify the startup file. Now let us go to the timer part. Okay, timers. Okay, I will keep it there. I will change. Okay, I have time. So timers. Basically, if we talk about the timers, okay, so here, when I'm talking about the timer, I'm not talking about the SysTick. I am talking about GPT, General Purpose Timers. Okay. In this case, we are talking about GPT, not SysTick timer. Okay. Now let us see what are there in the timer or what are the different features which are available in the timer. So in total, there are 12 modules or 12 timer modules in the TM4C123GH6PM microcontroller. 6 are 16/32 bit and 6 are 64 bit. Okay. So 16, or you can say this is 16 bit and this is 32 bit. Okay. Or if needed, you can switch to 32, or here it will be 64. Done. So 12 timer modules are there. And in that, each this 16 or same for 32 also, okay, this will be same. Everything will be same in both the 32 and 64 bit blocks. So in each 16 or 32 bit timer block provides two 16 bit timer or counter. So you can use the timer for both timer related activities or counter related activities. Counter related activities means how many times the switch is pressed, that kind of jobs you can do, or blink an LED after a particular time, that will be timer related job. Counter related job means how many times the switch has been pressed, or for example, if you want to generate a tachometer, okay, if you want to develop some tachometer, prefer to use counter in that case, okay. Or if you want to make a LED chaser using timers, in that case you can use timers. Time based events can be generated, okay. So blinking an LED or so, blink LED or chasers. For that you can use timers, and if you want to read how many times the pulse has changed, you can use counters also. So similarly, there are two timers, timer A and timer B, okay. Similarly, in case of 64-bit timers also, you have both timer A and timer B. In short, there are two timers, timer A and timer B. Each has got 32-bit and 16-bit and 32-bit timers. Okay. Now, you can configure these timers to work independently. So it is not necessary that you have to use timer A and B all together. No, you can make them work independently. Okay. For different tasks, like they can work as timer, they can work as, for example, timer A is working for timers, and timer B is working for counter, or they can even be coupled to get complete 16-bit timers can be coupled to make 32-bit timer also. Similarly, 2 32-bit timer can be coupled to make 64-bit timer. Okay. And there is one more feature, which is real-time clock. You can use them to make RTCs where you have to generate a precise time to start some event. Okay, for that you can use this kind of timers also. So in this timer, it is almost similar to the timer that we have used in 8085 ICs. There are timer ICs in 8085. These timers actually provide you different modes of operation. Okay. So for that, you can go to the data sheet. So you can go for one shot periodic timer mode. Then you have, coming down, you have real time timer mode. You can go down, input edge count mode. Okay. Similarly, input edge time modes. So there are so many different timer based modes available, PWM mode and so on. We cannot cover all of them, but it is provided in here. Okay. So wait for the trigger mode and so on. So there are so many different modes available. Okay. So we can say one shot, periodic, input edge count, PWM generation, real time clock, and wait for trigger mode. So all these six different modes are there, and depending on your choice, you can use the timer for any one of these, using one of these six modes. Okay. So there are mainly control and status registers, okay, which will be used to control the functionality of these GPTM or general purpose timer blocks. Okay, so there are timer control register, which control the timer, the functionalities of the timer. We can read the current status of the timers using status register. We can generate interrupts using timer. Okay. So timer can also generate interrupts. We will see that, because that is what we were doing in the startup file. And we can generate external controls also. Externally also we can control the timer by using some switch and all. These timer can count both in upward direction and downward direction. Upward means going from 0, 1, 2 and so on. We can go upward. Okay, so this is your, suppose this is your ultimate count, 255, after that it will go zero. Okay, so it is count upward, something like this. Okay, so come something like this. This is your up counter. Similarly, you can go downward also. So 255, assume is the count, then 254, 54 and so on up to 0. So down counter is also allowed. So you can have this kind of counting process also. Okay. So both up and down counter is there. So you can use control register to define the way it should count, whether it should be counting upward or downward. We can use them for simple PWM, generating PWM pulses, pulse width modulation pulses, to synchronize two different or three different events. Okay, but remember, they are stalled during debugging process. So during the debugging, we cannot see all the features of the timer. Okay, because debugging actually stops the timer in running. And we can use the timers to trigger ADC sampling or DMA transfers. ADC sampling means timer can tell the system, okay, now start the ADC and take the samples of, suppose if you want just 10 samples to be read. So you can trigger the ADC and just read 10 samples from the analog to digital converter. And then you can process that according to your choice. So this is very helpful in many projects. So you may trigger ADCs and you can take samples from the ADC depending on the timer. Okay. So now to configure the timer, we have to use configure register. Okay. And now it is not necessary to keep an eye on the base addresses and the offset address because it is all there in the header file. In this register, there are basically three bits, 2, 1, 0, which are rewritable. So there you can have 8 different options available for you. Okay. So 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 2, and 0, 3 are reserved. 0, 4, 0, 5, 7 reserved. So you can use 0, 0. If you put 0, 0 there, in that case, that means all 0. In that case, it will become 16 32-bit timer. Okay, it will be acting as a 32-bit timer configuration. If you put 1 there, you will be using RTC, real-time clock feature. If you put 4 there, you will be using 16-bit timer mode. Okay, but in that, we will come to this. Okay, AMR and BMR, A and B are representing the timer A and timer B. In my presentation, I have put there N to represent timer A or B. In place of A or B, I am putting N in my presentation. Okay, so these are all the features or configuration related things. And then control registers are there. You can see and from the data sheet, no issues. So first of all, before initializing the timer, we should disable them. So first disable the timer, initialize the timer, and then start the timer. So don't start the timer or don't change any value in the timer when it is running. First, stop the timer, modify the timer according to your choice, and then and only then start the timer. Okay. Let us check how to use this particular feature. I will be jumping this part. Okay. I'll just show you how to use the timer. Okay. These are there. You can go and check the data sheet. Okay. In this lecture, we are going to check how can we use periodic timer mode and blink an LED on the basis of periodic time. Okay. So first, how to configure the timer. So for that, we can refer to the data sheet itself. What are the things or what are the sequence of events that we should follow to make periodic timer mode working? So these are the eight steps provided here, which we should follow to make the timer work. First, it is saying that disable the timer, whichever timer you are preferring, whether it is timer A or B, disable the timer by using timer control register. CTL register. In that register, there is one bit called TN. N small n here is your A or B. Okay. So timer A or B is enabled register. So go to this register, disable the enable bit so that the timer stops. Then after that, second step is to configure the register. For that, always put the value 0000000. This is the step for initialization of this particular mode. Then you have to tell or initialize the GPTM TA, okay, because we are going to use A. So GPTM TAMR register, and we are going to put 02 there because we are going to use periodic mode, not one shot mode. We will be using this mode. So we'll be entering 02 there. Then after that, we'll be using this register. So you can see that I have written the program in the same manner in which the initialization and working of this particular mode is explained in the data sheet. Okay, you can cross check from this particular page. So now, first provide the clock to the timer. Okay, so providing the clock will may initialize the timer, or initialize the timer 0 or timer A or timer B. Okay, then we have to disable the timer before configuring the timer. Then we have to use the configuration register. In that, we will be entering 0000. Then after that, we'll be telling the mode in which the timer will be working. We'll be using the periodic mode. So therefore, we'll be entering 02 in this particular register, mode register. Okay, this is MR means mode register. Then we will be using the count. We will enter the count up to which the counter should go. Okay, so for that we'll be using ILR register, and then use the control register to enable or start the counting. So this is all about the initialization sequence. So provide the clock, disable the timer, enter the value, start and tell the mode, and then start the timer. Okay, this is all about the timer's functionality. Let us see the project. Oh, what happened? I think I have changed the name. Anyway, I can show you. What happened? Okay, program has changed. So here you can see what I have done. Right now, I'm not using the startup file or anything. Okay, so according to the steps that is given in the data sheet, we have used all the steps. First, this part is to enable the GPIO for port F, because I'm going to make the LED on or off. Okay, this section is to control the port F only, because we have to make the LED on or off depending on the timer's event. Okay, so this is all previously done. So enabling the clock for port F, alternate function has been disabled. Okay, so we will not be using any alternate functions on the bit 2, that is the blue LED. Then the blue LED, we are making it out to output bit. Then we are enabling the digital enable on the bit number 2, or the port F's LED blue. Then we are writing the LED blue high. Done. We made the LED blue on up to this. This is all about the port F. Now coming to the timer. First, we are providing the clock to the timer. So timer, RCGC timer register, if you put 0, that means first disabling the timer. Okay. Okay, so here you have to remember, this is the position and this is the bit that you want to put there. So in the 0th bit location, enter 1. Okay, now what we are doing in the second, in the control register, we are entering 1. Okay, and then complementing it. So that means 0. So in the zeroth location of control register, it became zero. So let me show you control register. If I have very small time left, that is a problem here. Okay. So this is my control register. In the control register, see TAEN. So timer A, enable or disable, we can do here. So if you can check here, okay. So what we are doing here, we are disabling the timer by entering zero in that particular bit location. Okay. So done. So first we entered one and then complemented it. It means making it zero, or you can directly put zero there. Now, then we are configuring the register. So we have to put 00 there. So we have to put 00 in the config register. Okay. So we entered 00 in the config register. Then we are using the mode register. In the mode register, we are putting 2 so that we can use the periodic function. Okay. So we entered 02 in the mode register. Then after that, in the timer, we are telling that the counter should work as a countdown timer. Okay. So for that, the mode register, we are entering 1 in the fourth position. The fourth position, we are entering 1 and then complementing it. So it becomes 0. So it will make it countdown timer. Or if you put it 1 there, then it will be count up. Now in the ILR register, we are entering the count, which is, this count is equivalent to 16. Okay. 16. Okay. So 16 megahertz. So this is the equivalent hexadecimal for the 16 megahertz. So this is the time or count we have entered into the ILR register, timer zeros ILR register. And then we enabled the counting. Okay. Okay. The time is over, I think. Anyway, next class we will be talking about this program and we will see how we can use interrupt to make the LED on. Okay. On or off using interrupts on the timer.